and I was running when I first heard lipstick on the glass when Ellie sent it over, and I just stopped. And I was tired, but like, I just stopped. And was like, I love this chorus. So little things like that have stayed with me.
It's Absolute Radio. I've got Joel and Ellie from Wolf Alice. How are you guys doing? Are you well?
Good, thank you. Yeah.
Yeah. It's a shame we have to do this by Zoom, but at least we can, right? And we're having a catch up about your album, Blue Weekend, which I adore. I've just had it blasting down the street in Brighton. When did this start, the process for this latest LP? How long has it been kind of in the works?
Oh, well, I mean, some songs are, you know, years old, but I think we came together as a band to start working on the songs in 2019.
Well done.
Wolf Alice are really bad at time management. We don't know when anything happened.
That's cool though. So were they just sort of under demo titles and stuff, and then you sort of, when they appear to you as a band, they appear to you kind of thing, or is it, or was there a kind of real kind of focused approach to this record in terms of what you wanted to achieve with it, or quite an organic process?
Oh yeah, it was organic, I guess. No, you're right. I think songs just come when they come, and we're not really the kind of band that necessarily force things. And we had a bit of time off after the Brixton shows, which were the last bit of touring for Visions of a Life, and gave ourselves some time just to breathe. And then, yeah, went to an Airbnb in Somerset and just hung out for a few days. And it was with a couple of guitars, and just showed each other like the ideas we wanted to work on. Just went from there.
Oh, nice one. Why Somerset? Was there any reason for that, or just where you landed?
I think it was we just looked at the Airbnb and it was really nice, wasn't it? Excuse to get out of London, I think. That's why I went.
And with Visions of a Light, I mean, you did so many live shows surrounding that, didn't you? It was like 150 in a year or something. What was it like as a band to be static at that point and just sort of stop and be writing again together? How did that feel? Was it needed, do you think?
Yeah, it was definitely needed, I think. You don't want touring to become something that just, you know, is, you know, just a wheel in motion, you know, because it's such a special thing to do. And I think we were tired, and we also needed to probably reconnect with all that we'd left behind at home, you know? So it was welcomed for a bit.
Yeah, and then you're just like, let's go again.
Yeah.
Have you guys found it over the past sort of year with the pandemic and stuff? Have you been sort of keeping in close contact?
I mean, we've been lucky enough to be able to be doing quite a lot of rehearsals for a while now. We've been playing with a good friend of ours called Ryan, so that's been felt so lucky to have that to focus on. Mm. We came back about May last year from Brussels, and we had the summer. It's been a bit of both, I think, but having Blue Weekend to focus on during all this has been, yeah, it's been great.
Yeah, totally. Well, let's talk about the album, shall we? Because the two singles that you've put out, I think I was saying on air that it's such a brilliant way that you've done it, because the first single that we heard was, you know, this beautiful, your vocal sounds so good, Ellie, on it, The Last Man on Earth, and it really reminds me of a Kills track as well. I can really hear lots of Kills in the record too. And then, of course, followed it up by loads of riffs and everything. So it was a really great introduction as to the album as a whole. Why did you want to put that one out first?
All the other options, maybe it just felt a little bit more to be expected, perhaps. And as we were so excited to be putting out new music, we wanted it to, I don't know, feel big. And that song is, it's just big, even though it's not, you know, heavy or loud or whatever. But yeah, so it just kind of mirrored our excitement, really.
It's absolutely beautiful. And with the record and the tracks that I've been lucky enough to hear that I don't think everyone's heard yet, there's a wonderful kind of connection with your vocal that's so close sometimes. It feels such a, you know, sort of so close to the mic and so in your ears when you're listening to it. It's quite a personal record, as well as being quite expansive in sound. Was that quite important to you on this one?
As personal as it can be, that you don't want to keep it to yourself, you know. It's like when you release it onto the world, it's, you know, it's no longer yours. So it's, yeah, it's not so personal that it does, hopefully, like, you know, you want it to translate to other people. So it is our baby, this album.
yeah, for sure. And how was it working with Marcus Javs? What was that like?
Yeah, Marcus was great. Like, you know, we're not the easiest band to work with all the time, because we have this kind of silent bond sometimes for communicating, and it's always a bit tricky, I think, when someone has to try and break into like the inner Wolf Alice circle. But we you know, we were there for a lot longer than we were planning on it, and you know, Marcus has got like a wife and kid, and he didn't see them for ages, and he was great, and he's just got so much knowledge from such an era that, like, I think we respect, you know, has worked on some of our favorite records and understands like analog and warmth and big sounds. And yeah, it was a pleasure to work with Marcus, actually.
Amazing. Was there one day in the either the recording or demoing or writing process of this record you'll never forget? Is there one that will always stick in your mind as the Blue Weekend memory?
There's moments I can remember hearing some of the songs, like the first time hearing How Can I Make It Okay when Ellie sent it over. I remember being in my kitchen the first time I heard her demo for Last Man, and just like, there's feelings that are very special to me rather than like total memories, but there were the sensations I wanted to feel again when we were in Brussels. And every time you go and re-record something, you have this like special moment. Like, I remember actually I was running when I first heard Lipstick on the Glass when Ellie sent it over, and I just stopped, and I was tired, but like, I just stopped. And like, I love this chorus. So little things like that have stayed with me as much as the actual recording process. Yeah.
And with the record, is there anything on it that you'll take out on the road and it's kind of physical aspect you've never taken before? Anything like a new instrument or synth you've used, or anything that's crucial to the sound of this to replicate live?
I mean, having the piano and The Last Man on Earth, kind of, you know, we've got another thing for Ronnie Haskett, our sound engineer, to lug around. He's really not very happy about that. Yeah. So yeah, there's loads of, I mean, we've been playing with a string section and stuff, and with Ryan, as Joel said. So yeah, like, it does feel like a new era for us, kind of, in terms of how we're going to put our live show together and stuff.
You can do like the stage Nord in a piano frame or something, like people do. I've seen that a few times.
It gets spoken about.
But with that, let's talk about the sort of cinematic film that you're putting out to accompany this as well. The videos I've seen so far, I love that the sort of club performance as well. I think that's absolutely brilliant with the fisheye lens and stuff. So people can get tickets for this via your website, is that correct?
Yes, we think, yes.
Is that the silent Wolf Alice communication there?
Yeah, someone maybe should have told us that before we came on this interview. But if you're sure about it, then yes.
Okay, but it's just so nice, isn't it, with the time we've had to actually work on the visual aspects of a release, isn't it? Because it is, you know, when I grew up, we watched MTV and M2 all day long, and it was always a visual accompaniment to the music you were listening to. So how was that to film it? I bet it was lovely, wasn't it?
Oh yeah, it was such a good experience. We just had the best team and brilliant actors. You know, everyone involved was just amazing, and it was a really welcomed experience during such a not great year.
Well put. No, I totally get that. And of course, there was more visual performance from you when the Glastonbury live stream went out. Stone Circle, man, that's got to be up there as quite a special gig to perform, even though filmed, you know, it must have been quite special.
It was nice to play with each other after such a long time, and then the sun came out for us. And, you know, we love Glastonbury, we love going there, and we love playing there, it was fun.
Well, we're going to be playing tracks off the record like throughout the week, and obviously we play the singles as they come out, but is there one track on it that you would love people to hear?
I mean, we've got How Can I Make It Okay coming out, and we've had No Hard Feelings, and they're two of my personal favorites. I love a song that we have called Feeling Myself, which is on towards the end of the record, and I'm very proud of like the sonics and the mood and the kind of, it's like a swing to it that I'm really happy we managed to achieve, because it was a song from early on that Ellie had shown us a demo, and it really did, we did work on it for every sort of stage of writing this record, and it got there to the end, and yeah, I'm very proud of that moment.
I probably loved the sound of my voice a bit too much the other night, but I was chatting away on air about how I'd noticed so many references to like blue and the colour blue on releases over the past year. And I don't know if it's a subconscious, where did the title come from your perspective?
Yeah, well, it just came from a conversation. We were trying to find something to do pre-pandemic, but we were in Brussels recording, and I just mentioned, like, oh, well, when it was a really nice day, so I was like, oh, well, the next Blue Weekend, let's do this, blah, 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 blah. And Joel was like, that sounds like an album named Blue Weekend. And I think just some of the themes and stories within the album, I felt like could kind of, you know, on one hand, occur throughout someone's, like, a lifetime, or could just be one weekend, you know, and felt nice. And I guess the blue aspect came from somewhere nice, but, you know, it still applied to the songs that were perhaps not so nice or a bit more melancholy or whatever. And yeah, I think people, I guess, probably because of the sky and the sea, people like the colour blue.
This is what happened to me on air. I just started talking about the blue, the sea and the sky. But yeah, I think you're right. It's like a sort of calming colour that, I don't know, it just paints a picture straight away when you say Blue Weekend, doesn't it? Like you said, on many levels. Yeah. Well, I think the album is an absolute triumph. I was lucky enough to be on the panel of the judges for the Mercurys. And when I saw you perform, when you won it, we were just all sat on the winner's table, on the judges' table, sorry. And we were just like, see, there they are. It was absolutely brilliant. So, yeah, it's lovely to have you back and lovely to playing new stuff. But thank you so much, guys.
Well, thank you
so much.
Cheers.
Thank you. Look forward to seeing it live as well. I'm back on stages. All right, take it easy.